afternoon. It's my honor and privilege to welcome you to yet another edition of the Wednesday Wisdom. We seek wisdom from leaders in the education space. BW Education is a daily website on education. We have a monthly magazine on education, BW Education. And over the last 7+ months, we've talked to various leaders in the education space on what is happening in the education space, where is the education space headed. The new education policy has been brought to the fore. How are universities and educational institutions engaging with their stakeholders to implement the new education policy? To discuss all this, the future of education, to discuss the future of universities, we have Dr. Pankaj Mittal. Welcome, Dr. Mittal.
Hello.
Dr. Mittal doesn't really need an introduction to this August gathering, but it is customary to be able to introduce the guest. He is the Secretary General of the Association of Indian Universities, and in her role, she understands what's happening in education and what's happening in universities. Welcome, Dr. Mittal. Let me start by asking you, how have been the last 8 months for you personally and professionally?
Thank you, Dr. Batra. First of all, thanks for inviting me here and allowing me to share my thoughts with all of you. Thanks to Business World. When you talk of last 8 months, they have been totally, I should say, a new normal which we are seeing now, that the things which we were not doing in past or we were afraid of doing in past, for example, this type of a video conferencing, virtual conferencing, that has now become a everyday affair. And every day we are talking in so many conferences and having so many meetings online. So the world has really changed from, of course, the face-to-face to blended. Rather, right now it is online, and in future it will become blended. Okay. So there is a lot of change, and many of them are positive changes as well.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mittal, for being optimistic. I always believe that the future is better than the present, whatever may hold in present. And human beings are inherently resilient and innovative. We find ways to adjust to the new abnormal. So let me now start asking you, the new education policy envisages increase in gross enrollment ratios. It envisages multidisciplinary approach to universities. It puts a lot of focus on employability and skilling and grooming, So tell us, what are the leaps that the universities need to take as they reinvent themselves for the future?
See, Dr. Batra, I really feel that the new education policy, or the National Education Policy 2020, is a very, very forward-looking, innovative policy which has the potential to transform Indian higher education space. So many of the recommendations in the policy are worth implementing immediately. And I also say this, that many of the recommendations, rather more than 70% of the recommendations, are to be implemented by the universities. They don't have to look towards the government for implementing those recommendations. They can themselves implement the recommendations at their own level through their own board of studies, ACs, ECs. For example, when it is multidisciplinary education, and if it is a unitary university right now, so they have to see their student profile, teacher profile, the profile of the location where they are, the employment profile in that location, and then they can decide what disciplines are to be added. And for adding those disciplines, what type of infrastructure would be required, what type of equipment would be required, what types of library resources would be required, or human resources would be required. So, and then for that, how much of financing will be required. So they have to make plans in themselves if they want to become multidisciplinary, or even like, say, for increasing the GER, you were saying that GER has to be increased to 50% by 2035 as given in the policy. So for increasing the GER, what contribution an individual university can make in terms of maybe increasing the intake in many programs, maybe in terms of number of programs which are to increase, and also by way of having more online programs so that there are many ODL students who can contribute to the GER. And the GER, as you would also know, that AIU did a study. I personally also did a study on GER, and then we were talking about the whether GER is a correct parameter for measuring the access to higher education, because GER keeps the denominator the total group of the people in the age group of 18 to 23. But at present, the transition rate or the pass out rate at 12th class, the what we call is that completion rate. Completion rate means how many people out of the 100 in that age group have passed 12 is 42. So when 42 means out of 100, 42 are have passed 12th class in that age group. So if 42 people are available, how can we have GER as 50% in the higher education? Therefore, we have to spend a lot of time and energy on the school education and increase the completion rate at the 12th level, then only the higher education can improve. So universities have to keep all these factors into account while implementing the various recommendations of national education policy.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mittal. Now, you clearly rightly said that we need to prioritize. You know, there are things that we need to do now and there are things we need to do in the future. Tell us immediately, you know, technology, both as part of curricula and technology in terms of imparting education, have grown. What do you think Indian universities can do to be able to be at par with their global counterparts in terms of both technology in curricula and technology in imparting education?
The one positive impact which the COVID had was that it has taught Indian higher education system to be sort of online and be technology friendly. And I would also say that rather I should compliment my, so I should compliment my teachers that before COVID, most of the teachers, more than 90% of the teachers, they were afraid of teaching online. They didn't know how to teach online. But after the COVID struck, in no time, almost within a month, most of our teachers were online. They were teaching online. But the issue is that there is, of course, a digital divide in the country. Every student doesn't have access to the devices, to the internet, to the required bandwidth. Therefore, the primary responsibility of the universities now would be seeing this COVID type of situation and seeing that the future is blended mode of education. They have to invest a lot on the technology. Technology in terms of devices, technology in terms of networking, technology in terms of bandwidth, and also technology in terms of having required number of software platforms on which the online education can be imparted. And apart from technology or infrastructure, but more is required immediately is the capacity building of the teachers. Capacity building of the teachers, both for teaching online and also for preparing open education resources, so that in future the blended education is the new normal, then they should be knowing how to teach online and how to even prepare OERs, open education resources, because then only they'll be able to take this blended education forward. So it is for the universities to invest on the technology rather than brick and mortar buildings. I mean, you saw that for 7-8 months, all the buildings were lying empty in all the universities, all the labs, buildings, huge buildings which we had created were lying empty. So we were relying on the technology. I'm not saying buildings are not required. They are required. But right now, more emphasis should be on the technology, investment on the technology, both in terms of infrastructure as well as in terms of capacity building of the teachers as well as the students.
Thank you so much, Dr. Mittal. Now, you know, there is often this talk that Indian universities, I mean, look at a certain Chinese university that's now in the top 20. And I believe all the rankings that exist globally are unfair to India because the way they are structured, they will always bring global universities to the fore. We as Indian universities have our own Indian strengths, right? So tell us, you know, what is your view in terms of the strengths that the Indian universities, the top Indian universities have, and how do you think they can, what do they have to offer to the world, so to say?
Indian universities do have their own strengths. We have our own ancient knowledge system. One thing which Indian university also invests is in the value education, the values it imparts to the student so that he becomes a good citizen in future. And above all, the university social responsibility. Our universities do take a lot of activities for the welfare of the community around the university. And I also personally feel that all the universities in the world, they should be committed towards the community development, because when the university, I mean, its first university was established in the world, in India itself. So when a university is established, it is also felt that with the establishment of this university, the community around the university will develop and there will be a strong connect between the community and the university. But slowly, slowly that connect has disappeared because there is no bridge between the university and the community. Rather, there is a total disconnect. And the people who are within the four walls of the university, they feel that we are a better lot. We are sort of elite people and the four ones who are outside the four walls of the university are lesser mortals. So there is a need to reconnect between the university and the community, which the Indian universities are doing to a larger extent, but this is not counted anywhere. So in any of the global rankings, this is not counted, that the type of work which the Indian universities are doing with the community. The programs like Unnat Bharat Abhiyan, in which the universities are contributing towards the development of the community in terms of technology development, as well as customizing the technology for the farmers. So these type of activities we see about agricultural university, the way they are having the Krishi Vigyan Kendras and through which they are helping the common farmer. So this type of hand-holding with the community is not being done in other universities. And second issue is also the language issue, because most of the journals which are in Scopus and all these databases, they are in English, but we do have a lot of education in our local languages. So all that is not counted anywhere. And also when you talk of reputation survey, our Indian universities, we are not very good at marketing ourselves. We do a lot of work, but we don't market ourselves. We don't do any brand building. So brand building is an exercise which we need to do, especially through social media. Now it is becoming easy to do brand building through social media. But many of our universities don't even have a Twitter account. They don't even have a Facebook page. So the presence of social media is not there. So I feel that if they have to achieve, say, global rankings, of course, they have to improve on the research, teaching, international faculty, international students, teaching, learning, but they also have to do a lot of brand building so that they are in the reputation survey, people are able to recognize that, yes, this is a university and it has built its brand. This is my personal opinion, that brand building is very, very important.
I agree. I think a lot of Indian universities are world-class in the kind of students they have, in the kind of faculty they have, the infrastructure they have, the course curriculum they have. It's just that you're right, we don't trumpet ourselves like other institutions do. I think we need to be better at brand building, as you rightly say. Now, with a new ecosystem, when I say new ecosystem, there is a new environment. We're in a post-COVID era. We're talking of hybrid learning. Now, what are the changes in skills that each stakeholder needs to do? For example, what are the changes that an education administrator, I mean, a vice chancellor of the university is essentially the CEO of the educational ecosystem. What are the changes he or she needs to make in terms of how he or she governs? What are the changes a faculty needs to make? What are the changes that support staff needs to make? What are the changes that the students need to make? So I would want your, inputs on to deal with this new abnormal. What are the changes that each of the stakeholders needs to make?
Okay, first of all, I think instead of saying new abnormal, we should say new normal. So it's a new normal. I mean, there are good things to it and bad things to it. So it's a new normal and everybody is adjusting to that new normal. So when you talk about the changes, even in the National Policy on Education, a lot of recommendations for which the efforts have to be made by all the sectors you are talking about, whether it is vice chancellors or faculty or the support staff or the teachers or the students. So everybody has to contribute. For example, the universities, if I talk about the leadership has to decide whether they want their university to be research intensive or teaching intensive. And again, that will depend upon the student profile, teacher profile, profile of the university, profile of the employment industry around the university. So they have to decide whether they have, it has to be research intensive or teaching intensive. They have to decide that if it is to be multidisciplinary, what type of disciplines they want to add. Every discipline cannot be there in every university. That is almost impossible. But if it has to be multidisciplinary, what type of disciplines they would want to add? If they have to make their university sort of in the programs, you know, I have to make it 4 years, what type of efforts they have to make, if they have to have multiple entry and exit, how will they make the ordinances to make it multiple entry and exit, if the acts of the universities require changes, because even the abolition of affiliation system is there, the acts of many universities have to be changed, especially the state universities. So they have to identify what type of changes are required in the act and then go to the respective state government or the central government for making amendments in the act. The BOG has to be there as administration, the NP. The leader of the university has to see that how the BOG concept would be included in the act of the university and how it will be incorporated. So there will be changes required in the acts, there will be changes required in the ordinances, there will be changes required in the statutes. And earlier done the better, because most of the universities, they have to undergo all these three changes in the statutes, in the ordinances and the acts. But they have to identify what all changes based on their own local conditions and then go ahead with it. Similarly, when you talk of the faculty, a lot of independence is given to the faculty in terms of what to teach, how to teach, and how to assess and evaluate the students. So they have to decide that what type of, say, for example, when you talk of multiple entry and exit, so it's easier said that, okay, we'll have a certificate or diploma after first year or the second year. But the curriculum has to be redone in such a manner that every year is a capsule in itself, because it cannot be first part of the some particular course is taught in the first year and second part in the second year. So there will be no, then you cannot be doing the multiple entry exit, because a capsule type program will not be there. There's a need for having a capsule type of program. There will be need to have a capsule type of program for every year, so that multiple entry and exit can happen. Similarly, in the way of teaching. Now, the way we teach and the way in foreign countries the teachers are teaching, we are mostly teaching in a lecture mode where we are teaching in the class and the students go and study at home. But in the foreign countries, it is a flipped classroom model where the resources, whether it's audio, video, or text, is given to the students, and in the class only discussion happens. So now it depends upon the teacher that how they want to teach the students. Obviously, the flipped classroom method is better. So they have to identify the resources which have to be given to the students in the beginning, or they have to create resources for their own course so that the flipped classroom model has to be adopted. Similarly, the faculty is also to decide how to assess the students. Is the 3-hour examination in the end of the semester good enough, or there should be multiple ways of assessment, continuous assessment throughout the semester? It could be quizzes, it could be assignments, it could be projects, it could be activities, it could be face-to-face interview, it could be group discussion. There are so many multiple ways of assessing the student. So what type of way the student, the faculty wants to adopt, that they have to see. How they want to evaluate the student, how they want to grade the student, they have to see. So all this effort has to be made by the faculty at their own level. And when you come to the students, I think students are the king in this policy. They are having the freedom of not only the speech, freedom of choosing a subject, freedom of choosing a university, rather multiple university within a program through the most innovative concept of academic bank of credit. They are having the freedom of speech. So when all these freedoms are given to the students, the student becomes the king. But then again, it depends upon the passion of the student on how much they can learn. Because in future, the jobs will not be given on the basis of a degree. Jobs will be given on the basis of the knowledge base you have. And today is the time when you can have the maximum knowledge through online resources, that too free of cost. So if you did not get admission in IIT, don't worry. IIT professor will come to your home and teach you on your laptop at your convenient time. So this type of flexibility was never given in past. So if the students have the passion, and in Hindi we call it lagan, agar unke paas lagan hai seekhne ki, to sky is the limit. So they can learn anything, and they should look forward to this. The type of OERs we have, the type of MOOCs courses we have, they can learn really well and they can perform very well in the future life. So the policy has opened something, umpteen number of opportunities before the students.
Dr. Mittal, now you are representing the Association of Indian Universities, Secretary General. Now, as an association, what are the initiatives that you are doing to be able to help realize the new education policy?
I'm glad that you asked that question. We are doing lot many things for our higher education community, especially for the university and the teachers. For example, One, the AIU is now automating itself. Till now, the equivalence of degrees was given on paper basis. I mean, a lot of time was consumed in that. Now, the equivalence of foreign degrees with the Indian degrees, which is a mandate given to AIU by the MHRD, now MOE, is done online. So now you have to apply online and you can get the equivalent certificate online, which is downloadable. So this will help a lot in the internationalization, because now the students can very freely go to the foreign country, get the degree, come back, study here. So that is one aspect. Second, we have started an AIU portal. AIU portal, there are many, many things. One is admission portal. So if in AIU admission portal, we are requesting all the universities to fill up their details about the programs they are running. So if a student, say, wants to do, say, MA in history, and he puts MA in history on the AIU portal, down will come all names of all the universities which are running this program. So it is easier for the student to locate a university where he wants to study. Similarly, we are trying to have, for promoting internationalization, one AIU collaboration portal. Because right now I have observed that many universities, especially foreign universities, when they want to collaborate with Indian universities, they don't know which university to collaborate with. For example, if they want to collaborate, say, in quantum physics, so they don't know which Indian university is good in quantum physics. They do know that this is the university which is good as per NIRM ranking or as per NAC rating. But for a particular area, which university is good, they don't know. So we are starting an AIU collaboration portal in which for every university, the best 5 or 6 departments will be given, which are ready for collaboration, along with the sort of credentials in terms of publications, faculty, facilities, books, whatever those that department is having. So this will facilitate. So now next time any university from a foreign country wants to collaborate in quantum physics, and when they write quantum physics on the AIU collaboration portal, it is in the making right now. So down will come the list of the universities in India which are very good in quantum physics. So it will be very easy for them to collaborate. One more thing which we are doing for our faculty is that we are partnering with some agencies for offering online programs for our faculty for training them, especially sort of faculty development program. So that will be a program which will teach them how to teach online, how to prepare research projects, how to do this flipped classroom model learning, how to do blended learning, what are the techniques involved, what are the techniques involved in instructional designing. So like this, we are running many, many faculty development programs, online faculty development programs for our teachers. And lastly, to promote internationalization, what we are doing is establishing a Indian network of international educators. What happens is that most of the countries have a network of international educators like NAFSA, you know, but India did not have so far a network of international educators. So we are making a network of international educators in which the best universities in the country which are doing internationalization, and the ones who are not very good but they want to do internationalization. Because in our country, there are all kinds of universities. There are universities who want to do internationalization, but they don't know how to go about it, how to talk to a foreign university to talk to, which professor to bring in, which university to collaborate with. So we are trying to build a network in which there will be a lot of information sharing, and the universities would be able to interact with each other for promoting internationalization of higher education. So these type of initiatives AIU is taking right now.
Dr. Mitchell, thank you for sharing what AIU is doing. I'm sure it makes a difference to the students and, most importantly, to all the stakeholders in the university ecosystem. Now, I just want to ask you this question, that do the mindset of institutions like yours and other regulators in the education ecosystem also needs to change? Don't they need to keep pace? Because earlier, education, you know, regulator would say, oh, we need that many buildings, we need that much infrastructure. That would become the criteria. But as you rightly said, that buildings are lying empty. Technology investments and building human capital have much more ROI, so to say, than just building a building. So tell us, what are the mindset changes that the decision makers in terms of policy, whether it's the ministry, whether it's the secretary, whether it's the regulators, whether it's an association like yours, tell us, what are the mindset changes leaders that head these institutions need to make?
See, when you saw this policy, that policy was depicting the mindset of our leaders. leaders and even the administrators, whether it is the Ministry of Education or UGC or...
Absolutely. It's very progressive, it's very comprehensive, and it lays a very clear vision ahead.
Yes. So it really
shows... Very progressive and ambitious vision.
Yes. So that vision is already evident through the policy. And in the policy, you will see that a lot of independence, a lot of autonomy has been given to higher education institutions. And even to the teachers as well as the leaders of higher education. When you talk of board of governors, that means, I mean, this I have seen for the first time, that the policy itself is talking about absence of political interference. So they say there will be a BOG so that there is no political interference in the appointment of vice chancellors, also in the running of the university. So the mindset is already evident that they are wanting to have an independent, autonomous higher education system, which goes, I mean, in a fast pace to improve the quality of higher education and to allow the Indian universities to be in the top world ranking universities. So everybody is working towards that direction, whether it is the minister or the ministry or the UGC or the associations like AIU. Everybody is working that direction so that the policy doesn't remain a dream, it really becomes a reality. So I think now it is in the good hands and it will be done very fast.
Thank you so much. My last question to you, if I talk to a year from now, what are the three predictions you want to make that you think will happen over the 12 months?
Which I can?
See happening over the next 12 months. You know, when I talk to you in 12 months from now, what do you think will get implemented in the next 12 months or needs to get implemented in the next 3 months? Immediately.
I think especially this in next 12 months, I think ABC will come into existence, Academic Bank of Credit. The regulations will be there and the special purpose vehicle which will sort of implement ABC, that will be in place. And once ABC is in place, it will be a total freedom for the students to do any course from any university and keep on accumulating credits. One is that. Second, I think most of the university within 1 year will start having multidisciplinary education. They will start adding disciplines. Maybe it will not be all the disciplines in one go. Maybe they'll start adding disciplines slowly. And also the NRF will be in place. And National Research Foundation will look into it as a research in the country is done at a faster pace and the quality research is there.
Thank you. Thank you so much for talking to BW Education. For our viewers and readers who missed it, you can visit the BW Education YouTube page or read it in the next issue of BW Education or read it on bweducation.com. So thank you, Dr. Mittal, for talking to us. You're right that the progressive mindset of the policymakers is evident in the national education policy. That envisages is a long-term roadmap and vision for reforming and reinvigorating Indian education ecosystem. And I'm sure with this intent, the execution will also match the intent. And I'm sure all the stakeholders will rise to the challenge and leverage the opportunity. So thank you for laying out the vision. And I'm sure you as the Secretary General of the Association of Indian Universities will play a pivotal role in making it happen. So we wish you luck and we look forward to a conversation with you soon enough. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for inviting me here.
Pleasure.
And it was a lively discussion, very frank discussion. Thanks for making it so lively. Thank you.
Thank you so much.